So what's he doing today? Riding around like he's on a mountain bike, when he's clearly on something with mudguards, a carrier, and 700c wheels. Well, that's kind of my point really. I'm making a point. And I'm making a case for a much maligned type of bicycle. One that we call the hybrid. It's called the hybrid because it was meant to be a hybrid between the mountain bike and the road bike. To all intents and purposes, it looks like a mountain bike with skinny wheels or a touring bike with flat handlebars. This particular version, particularly the latter, because it's made by Dawes, it's got a lugged steel frame, and that's because Dawes are, or were, renowned touring bike manufacturers, and they saw a marketing opportunity and a sales opportunity for these hybrids, so it was easy for them to do. They just beefed up their touring bike and made it down to a price to a certain extent for the market, less specialist market, and this was the result. But we're getting ahead of ourselves. Let's just go back to concept here, to first principles. We're going back to the 1990s, the late 90s particularly, but the idea started really before then. But let's look at the 90s when this bike was made. And that's the days before the internet, the days before YouTubers were influencing and highlighting alternatives, people like Pathless Pedaled promoting the gravel bike and that sort of thing. We had the newsstand magazines. That was the cycling media. And they came in two flavours, mountain bike or road bike. Unless you were a cyclist and were a member of the CTC and you had access to cycling magazine, really what you saw were mountain bike magazines telling you why Xtreme is better and road bike magazines telling you why lightness and speed is all you need. And that's not what people wanted, it's not what people needed, but it's what people were told was the best. It's like the Top Gear culture, where we're led to think that the ultimate car is something so specialist that you can't drive it really on public roads with any kind of convenience. It's that kind of mindset, because that's what sells advertising, that's what gets magazines picked up off the shelves. In those days, in the magazine industry, the customer buying the magazine was the customer. The magazine was the product. And so it still is with enthusiast magazines, but the mainstream magazines nowadays, the advertiser is the customer. And the attention of the reader is the product. The magazine's merely a delivery system. But back in those days, we had bike shops the same as the magazines. We've got both types of bicycles, so road bikes and mountain bikes. And it was the Americans first. I can't think who was the first manufacturer to do this. But it definitely came from America. May have been... No, I can't say. I can't say who it definitely was. But my mind is hovering on Specialized, Mike Senyard's company. Now, they came over from America as stripped down bikes. They were like a mountain bike with 700c wheels. In Europe, we had the influence of the German trekking bikes, which were very well equipped. This kind of thing, but better equipped and higher quality and expensive. And in Britain and the other English-speaking countries, people won't spend that much on a transport bike. They'll spend it on sports equipment, but not a transport bike. So the British manufacturers, Raleigh were one of the first, Saracen were excellent at the game, and Dawes too. They tailored the concept to the British market. So what they created was, I think, one of the best bike designs there's ever been. Yes, there's the 3-speed 26-inch Roadster and such as that, but in terms of a general purpose versatile bicycle, this is pretty hard to beat. You've got a bike that you can go touring on. You've got a bike that is basically made for commuting. And looking back to that age, particularly in Britain, the 90s, that was the big expansion of the cycle route network. Sustrans were spearheading the National Cycle Network, and cycle trails, both leisure and commuting, were opening up right throughout the country. And families and individuals wanted a bike that they could take out on those trails. Look what he's done here, look what he's done, he's cross-chained. Oh no, this idiot here has ended up with it on the small chain ring and the small sprocket. You should never do that. What an idiot I am. Anyway, getting back to the 90s, families were looking for something they could take out on the weekend with the family, and the popularity of child trailers, better quality child seats and things like that exploded, along with the long distance trails like the Tarka Trail and the Tishington and High Peak, and Bristol Bath, of course, preceded it. That whole network was springing up and people wanted to be part of it. It was a lovely thing for people to do on a weekend, and these bikes were perfect. So there was a massive untapped market. Cycle commuting was being heavily promoted. Again, perfect machine for the average commuter, the average non-enthusiast commuter. I think we have to keep non-enthusiast in our minds here, because these were never enthusiast bikes. These were bikes for the people. If this was a car, it would be a Ford Sierra Estate or an early Mondeo Estate. If it was in Germany, were they still called Mondeos in Europe? I think they were. The Cortina had been called the Taunus, but I think they all went over to being the Mondeo. And so it was your mid-range Ford or General Motors family station wagon. You'd never see that on the front cover of a car magazine. You'd never see it being tested on TV on Top Gear, but you would see it in every car park. You'd see it at every weekend recreation spot. And that's what these are. These are the mid-range family Ford station wagon of bicycles. Perfectly competent, pleasant to use, very practical. But of course they were maligned. The mountain bike enthusiasts hated them because they weren't mountain bikes, and they could show what you could do without a mountain bike. Through most woodland trails, you'd manage fine on one of these. And when you've just spent $2,000 on a mountain bike, you don't want to hear that. Likewise, when you've spent a lot of money on a high-end touring bike, you don't want people to know that they can spend £250-300 on a bike that will take them perfectly well on a week's tour around Britain or Europe, particularly roads and cycle trails. And they'll probably end up more comfortable. I remember Edward Enfield, Harry Enfield's father, also writes for the Oldie magazine. He did some cycling books. One of my favourites is Downhill All the Way, where for his 60th birthday he rode from Calais to the Riviera. And he did it on a Dawes Civic, which was basically a 5-speed, more towny version of this. He wouldn't have been comfortable on a Dawes Super Galaxy Top End Tourer. I'm 60 now and I wouldn't be. I've given up drop handlebars. So I think enthusiast snobbery has a lot to answer for the maligning and almost demise of the hybrid, in Britain at least. But to me, they're one of the the best and most versatile bike designs there's ever been. And if you haven't ridden a hybrid before because you think they're neither nothing nor something, or they're too mountain bikey for you, or they're too road bikey for you, borrow one, buy one, hire one, because they really are a smashing bike. And that's it. They're, for someone who isn't a bike geek, they're just a really nice bike. Now this one, this is a late 90s door street life, not high end, not low end, and it's low mileage. I found it abandoned in the back of a hire place that I did some work with. It had belonged to a previous employee and he just left it behind, couldn't be bothered with it, it needed a couple of jobs. If you're a regular, you will have seen it being recommissioned over the course of a few videos. I put it up for sale. Nobody was interested. I've still got it. It's still actively for sale. If you want it, here it is, come and get it, in the words of the song. But in the meantime, I just jump on it now and again and enjoy it. I've just had a thrash around the neighbourhood. Had a great little time selecting an inappropriate gear combination. I'm not going to live that one down. At least I'm honest, at least I didn't edit it out. Yeah, the downsides of hybrids. I remember I went through a period of hating them when I ran Bike Rescue, the bike recycling scheme in York, which I founded. We used to get a lot of hybrids in. York's the kind of place where there were a lot of hybrids. I got to dread getting a hybrid in because when we got them, to be fair, they'd been run into the ground by everyday commuters. And so they would always need a back wheel. The back wheels on anything but a high quality hybrid were always a bit marginal. By the time you got some shopping on the back and a heavy-ish rider, you'd probably exceeded the proper weight limit of the rear wheel. So it always needed a rear wheel. The whole drivetrain was always worn out. So you've got chain rings, chain, cassette, a full set of four cables. The brakes would be down to the metal, so you'd need the brake pads. You'd need a pair of tyres. You'd need a back wheel. How would it pay for itself then? You'd have to charge the kind of money you could buy a new bike for, or the kind of money you could buy a new cheap hybrid for. And a lot of these were cheap hybrids, and we just had to write them off, some of them, because once the bottom brackets were going as well, and the cheap bikes, they just weren't worth it. They were running to the ground. So, by the same token, that means they'd done really well for somebody. Somebody'd been able to run them into the ground. But the concept was, I suppose, spoiled a little bit by the industry's attitude of turn them out as cheaply as possible and kind of cheapen the concept, really. Also, the cheaper ones tended to come as a bare bones bike, so you'd have to buy mudguards, you'd have to buy a carrier, etc., and probably a decent saddle. So yeah, I did get to a stage where I dreaded seeing a hybrid, because I could see us spending £120 doing it and being able to sell it for like £80-90. And it always saddened me to write a bike off. But I'm past that now. And I think a nice steel hybrid like this one, as I've said, is something well worth getting. So I'm just going to repeat myself if I bang on anymore. I've put the case for the hybrid. If you want a bike, you've got space for one bike only, you want something a little bit classic, get yourself a nice steel framed hybrid. You'll enjoy it every time you get on it. It won't give you backache, and it'll do pretty much anything you ask of it. So there we are. Enjoy your cycling, get a hybrid, and if you want to buy this one, contact me, it is for sale. That that's better. Select some proper gears. Problem with having too many bikes, you lose the feel for each individual bike's gear changes and such like. And I still don't like derailleurs as much as a hub gear.